maybe there's a way to bring other people in. Okay, so let's continue. We have been talking about the approximations to the two basic methods of discounted infinite horizon problems, value iteration and policy iteration, and we saw the approximate version of value iteration. Now let's go into an approximate version of policy iteration. Okay, so policy iteration starts with a policy, evaluates it, then computes an improved policy, and so on. Approximate policy iteration simply involves an approximation at the policy evaluation stage. Instead of solving the corresponding evaluation equation exactly, which is a linear equation of potentially gigantic size, we consider an approximation to that, which involves an approximation architecture and a parameter R. And then we use this approximation to generate an improved policy. So how do we evaluate the typical policy mu in this box here? We will use a linear cost function approximation involving a matrix of features phi. Phi is a full rank n by n matrix with columns which are the basis functions, and the ith row is denoted by phi sub I prime. It's the same notation as we had earlier. And the policy improvement, once I have an approximation from this box here evaluating the current policy mu, policy improvement is obtained from this equation, and I assume that this is done exactly. You could consider approximations to this minimization, but we'll assume that it's done exactly. What we want to focus on is how to deal with this approximate policy evaluation for the moment. If you do this, and if the policy evaluation is approximate to within delta, okay, then there's an error bound that says that the successive policies come to within this expression from the optimum. And by the way, this is exactly the same error bound as approximate value iteration. So approximate value iteration and approximate policy iteration give you the same error bound, even though they're different methods. It just turns out this way. So that's the overall framework. And now we want to focus on approximate policy evaluation. So I mentioned last time that there are two approaches. One is the direct method, and the other one is the indirect method. In the direct method, we have this J mu that we want to approximate, and we project it down within the approximation subspace. And we could use simulation to do that, as I mentioned earlier. This approach is legitimate, but it is not very popular. And there are quite a few reasons for that. One of them is that to calculate this J mu, samples of J mu, you need to do simulation. For a given state, you need to calculate the corresponding cost of the policy. So you have to run the policy many times and average to obtain an approximate version of just one sample of J mu. And then you have to do this for many states. And there's a lot of noise in this, a lot of simulation noise involved in this process. And this noise shows up when you try to use this method. You find that you need an extreme amount of simulation. So people don't use this method very much. Instead, the more popular method is the indirect method, whereby instead of projecting the solution, you project the equation itself. This is called the Galerkin method, and it amounts to solving this equation. If there was no approximation, then we would not need a projection here. So what we do is we project the equation and try to find an R that satisfies this equation. So the solution has the property that when you apply T to it and then project down, you end up at the same point. That's the concept of the solution here. So let's accept that this is a legitimate method. It has error bounds. It's something that does work to a certain extent in practice. How do we implement it? How do we find approximately a solution to this by simulation? That's our issue. Well, first of all, generally projection, as I mentioned, can be implemented by simulation in least squares. So somehow we have to find a way to factor in simulation in least squares into this equation here. Okay, so let's focus on this method that uses indirect policy evaluation. Given the current policy, we solve this projected equation, and then we approximate. So basically, we approximate the solution of Bellman's equation with the solution of the projected equation. And what are the questions here? Well, first of all, does the projected equation have a solution? How do we know that it has a solution? How do we know that it has a unique solution? So so this is the same as asking, under what condition is this mapping, pi t, a contraction so that pi t has a unique fixed point? And remember, this is the same issue that we raised earlier. Under what circumstances the t mapping and the projection are matched so that pi t is a contraction? So now here's the magical thing. We are going to determine a weighted norm under which this is a contraction. And here's the assumption. We assume that the Markov chain corresponding to the current policy is ergodic. It has a single recurrent class and no transient states. So you plug in this policy, Markov chain runs, and it visits all states infinitely often with certain long-term frequencies. And these long-term frequencies are these steady-state probabilities. Okay, this is standard Markov chain theory. You have a single recurrent class, no transient states, then the steady-state probabilities, okay, these are occupation measures or the average probability that you will be at state j if you start at state I in the limit. This is independent of where you start, and it is positive. So this steady state distribution, which is the distribution involving the long-term frequencies of the various states, is a positive vector. Okay? And now we are going to use projection with respect to this vector, and things will work out. This is the magical norm that we're looking for. And here's a proposition. Suppose that the projection is with respect to this distribution norm, okay? Then pi t mu is a contraction of modulus alpha with respect to this norm. And moreover, the unique fixed point of this mapping, which is what we are going to use to approximate chain mu, has an error bound that satisfies this relation. Okay? Notice that what you get is not the projection of j mu, but the distance of j mu from this approximation is bounded by a scalar multiple of the distance of j mu from the approximation subspace, always with respect to this norm. For the moment, this bound is not important. What's important is that I have found some sampling distribution with respect to which to do the projection so that I get a solution of this equation. And the process and the divergence that I experienced in the previous method does not occur. Okay. So let's say a few things about why this thing works. First of all, let's talk about projections. An important property of projection onto a subspace spanned by the columns of a matrix phi is the Pythagorean theorem. Okay. projection, this vector is orthogonal to this vector here, and the square of this norm is equal to the sum of the squares of these two norms. Okay? This is an abstract extension of the classical Pythagorean theorem for triangles, for orthogonal triangles. And the orthogonality, of course, is with respect to this psi here. And here is the second important fact for us. Projection is non-expensive. If you project two vectors, J and J bar, with respect to a projection, a weighted Euclidean projection norm, then the distance of the projection is smaller, or at least no larger, than the distance of the vectors. And the proof of this is one line. The difference between the projections, which is this because pi is linear, is less than that plus some positive thing. And by the projection theorem, by the Pythagorean theorem, this sum here is equal to J minus J bar. Let's not focus on this algebra. Just suffice it to say that's a one-line proof based on the Pythagorean theorem. Now, here is the important theorem, and it applies to any Markov chain that is ergodic. Suppose that you have a Markov chain that corresponds, let's say the one that corresponds to a policy mu, and P is its transition probability matrix, and Xi is the steady state probability vector corresponding to this Markov chain. Then you have this inequality holding. Okay. So take any vector z, apply this probability, this transition probability, sort of randomize it according to t, and you get something that's smaller, has smaller norm. Okay. The proof of this takes like 5 minutes to go through. It involves, you do the natural things, take the square of that, write it in terms of xi, okay, this is equal to this by definition, and then you use, okay, there's a convexity property of the quadratic that you use here, and using the steady state, okay, take this out here, and then use the definition of steady state probabilities, you get this equality, and this is precisely the norm of z squared. So it's a one-line proof, a little tricky, but it still fits in one paragraph. So that's not the time to do these detailed proofs here, but I want to show you that this is relatively simple. Now, once I have this relationship, then I use the non-expensiveness of phi and the definition. The definition of t mu sub j involves the cost vector of mu and also the transition probability matrix of mu and the difference. Okay, I want to see how to look at the difference of pi t applied on two generic vectors j and j bar. Because of this inequality here, when you subtract these two, this goes away. And what's left is, okay, first we use the non-expensiveness of the projection, okay, to get this relation. And this relation is equal to this. And now I use this lemma to get the last part of the inequality, which says that pi t is a contraction with modulus alpha. So that's it. Very simple proofs to establish the right norm for projection, which is the steady state distribution of the current policy.
Yes,
you use the property of the ergodic. because if psi does not have positive components everywhere, then this is not a norm anymore. Okay, you have to have positive components of psi for it to qualify as a norm. Okay. Okay, so there is also this proof of the error bound, and again, it's a one-line proof, which I will not go through. The first equality here uses the Pythagorean theorem. The second inequality uses, the second equality is because J mu is a fixed point of T, and phi r star, the approximation, is a fixed point of pi T. Finally, this, by the fact that pi T is a contraction of modulus alpha, gives you this. Take this on the other side and divide, and you get the result. That's that. So what this says is that if you project J mu according to this psi distribution of the corresponding Markov chain, then the error that you get is something that is bounded by the minimum possible error over the approximation subspace. Okay. So all of this fuss was to show this proposition. Okay. Now what we're going to do is put this proposition into practice using simulation. So we have the projected equation, and we want to see how do you solve it by simulation. Again, here's the figure. We have a given policy, and the T mu mapping is given by this, with pi being the distribution, the transition probability matrix of mu, and g being the cost vector. And I want to find r, where phi r is an element of the approximation subspace that solves this equation here. Okay, now I have a projection here from T mu of phi r into phi r. And this distance is orthogonal to the approximation subspace. This is the orthogonality principle. In particular, the error, the difference between this and that, this broken line, okay, is orthogonal to the subspace spanned by the columns of phi. Okay, so this error is orthogonal to the columns of phi, but orthogonal in the sense of the psi norm. Capital psi here is a diagonal matrix with a steady state probabilities along the diagonal. Okay, so that's what we mean by orthogonality. Orthogonality with respect to the scaled norm of projection. So the projected equation is equivalent to a matrix equation. And this matrix equation is just this, C R star equals to D, with the matrix C being, you read it from here, phi xi times I minus AP times phi, and the constant is this times that. Okay. So now this projected equation that seemed a little abstract, it has become very concrete. It's just a matrix equation. What's the dimension of this matrix equation? It is small. Small because the row dimension, because the column dimension of phi is small. So this equation is S by S, not N by N. Okay? It's a low dimensional equation. However, computing this matrix, so if I could compute this matrix C and the vector D, that would be great. It would, that you can give to MATLAB, okay? It's a low dimensional matrix inversion. Give it to MATLAB, it will give you the answer. But there is a catch here. You cannot calculate this matrix C easily because it involves vector matrix or matrix multiplies that are high dimensional. this phi prime matrix is like this. And it's multiplied with a big, with a gigantic diagonal matrix psi, and that gigantic matrix again, n by n. So this is a huge calculation. Even though the end result is low dimensional, this is a huge calculation. Similarly here, I have this phi prime, which is like this, multiplied with psi, which is gigantic, and multiplied with g, which is also gigantic. All these inner products end up giving you a low dimensional vector, but carrying out these calculations is difficult. What's the answer to this? Well, last time I mentioned that the primary use of simulation within our context is to be able to make huge inner products, make them manageable by sampling instead of adding all the terms. And similarly, that's what we do here. We calculate simulation-based approximations of C and D that are manageable, and then we use the approximations in place of the real things in this equation and get an approximation to R star. Okay. So, suppose that I give you C and D. Somehow, in a magical way, we have found C and D. I can solve this by matrix inversion, assuming, of course, that C is invertible, okay, which is not entirely a trivial issue. Assuming that it's invertible, you can use just matrix inversion. The alternative to matrix inversion is to solve this linear equation by iteration. Linear equations are solved in two ways, either by matrix inversion or by using some kind of an iterative method to solve them. In particular, we may try to use this iteration, which is called projected value iteration. It's similar to the one that we discussed earlier, fitted value iteration. At iteration k, you have phi sub rk, an approximation of what you're trying to compute, the j mu vector. Apply pi t to it, and then get a new approximation and keep going. So here's projected value iteration. You are at phi sub rk. You go to t sub phi of rk, which is this expression here. Project it down, get rk plus 1. Then get another one, project, and so on. Now, this can be also written in terms of the matrices C and the vector D. In particular, the projected iteration tries to find the vector rk plus 1 such that the distance between these two is minimized. Okay, so this is a least squares problem in R. Setting the gradient of this objective to 0, you get this equation here. And after you manipulate it, you see that the new vector rk plus 1 is given by the old vector times some correction, which is proportional to the residual, the error that rk makes in satisfying the equation. And there's also this matrix here. So again, this is a low dimensional iteration, but it involves some gigantic inner products in here, in here, and here. And these gigantic inner products, our next step is to address them by simulation, to approximate them by simulation. These are two major methods for solving projected equations. But of course, the solution here is exact. The first one leads to a method called LSTD. The second one leads to a method called LSP. And we're going to get into this method shortly. There are also some other methods, but we can't get into those at present. OK. Are there any questions here? So now, what we're going to do is use sampling to approximate the matrix and vector involved in this projected equation. Approximate C with CK, approximate D with DK. And then after we do that, then the matrix inversion method is approximately implemented like so. This is the LSTD method, probably the most popular method for solving projected equations. Calculate by simulation approximations to C and D, and just use the inverse. The alternative is to consider this projected value iteration and replace this C with CK, replace D with DK, and replace this again with a simulation-based approximation, which is possible to do by sampling. And the key fact is that these approximations can be computed with low-dimensional linear algebra of order of the number of basis functions and not on the dimension of the space. Any questions? Okay. So now I have a matrix that I want to approximate by simulation. What do I do? Well, against the old trick. If you want to calculate quantities by simulation, you express them as expected values. Somehow you express them as expectation with respect to some distribution, and then you sample according to that distribution, and you make the approximation. It's similar here. We collect, now the main thing, what's important is to introduce a sampling method that involves the steady-steady probabilities of the Markov chain. So we can't generate samples arbitrarily, but instead we use the Markov chain to generate the samples. So we have this Markov chain. I want to involve in the simulation the size of that Markov chain. So I run an infinitely long trajectory of this Markov chain. It generates a sequence starting from this state, generates another state, and so on. Because of the ergodicity that I have assumed, all the states and all the transitions appear with long-term frequencies, psi I and pij, pij being the transition probabilities. With every transition that I generate, I compute the corresponding rho of phi, this is a low-dimensional vector, and the corresponding cost component. So a gigantic simulation, infinitely long, gives me a lot of samples of states and transitions with corresponding costs, and the states appear with this distribution, the transitions appear with a product of these two distributions. And now the formulas are given here. I want to approximate this vector here. Okay? It involves this matrix, psi, and this vector. I view this as an expected value. I write it like this, okay? If you expand phi and p and so on, it can be written exactly like so. And now you can see that it is an expectation involving these probabilities. Now my simulation generates these probabilities. They are the probabilities of these transitions. Xi is the probability of being at state I. Pij is the probability of going to state j afterwards. So this is the steady state long-term frequency of transitions like that. And the Monte Carlo estimate of this is precisely this. So that's the simulation-based estimate of the D vector. Run an infinitely long sequence. States and transitions occur with the right probabilities. And if you average this expression by Monte Carlo up to time k, we generate k samples, a finite number of samples, it's an approximation to this, that converges to it for k going to infinity, with an infinite number of samples. Notice that everything here is finite, is low dimensional. Phi is a small dimensional vector, and this is a number. So I'm just averaging small dimensional vectors. And nowhere do I have to deal with a large dimension of a Markov chain. It's the sampling that takes care of visiting the various states. Now the projected equation involves a matrix C and a vector D. The vector D is obtained like so. The matrix C is this matrix here. Again, low dimensional, but with gigantic inner products and matrix multiplies in here. And it turns out, okay, it takes a little bit of algebra to see that this can be written again as an expected value. And this expected value can be approximated by Monte Carlo like this. Okay, so look what this is. It's a small column vector multiplied with a small row vector, okay? So these are small matrices, small rank one matrices, which I average over a large number of transitions. And that's basically it. These are the formulas. And of course, there are extensions to this, but these are the basic formulas. If I also need to calculate this matrix here, I can also, the same simulation can give me a simulation-based approximation to this. And this is useful in the case of the iterative method.
To make this simulation happening for the infected, we still need the assumption, the marker for the chain distribution assumption. Do we need that assumption to make this method work?
Yes, yes, you're right. The question is the following. Do I need to know psi? I don't need to know it. I just let the Markov chain work. And automatically, it generates transitions and states according to psi and pij, right? So I need a simulator of the Markov chain.
Yeah, and to make this method effective, I mean, we need the assumption in one slide that we said we have one single recurring class and we have positive.
Right, yeah, okay. I'm right, you're absolutely right. Your question has to do also with whether we do need this assumption. We do and we don't, okay? We definitely need it for the theory as I gave it to you. But there's a version of the theory that allows you to allow approximations of Markov chains that are not ergodic. And then what you get with the simulation procedure is a little different, but it's still usable. Basically,
if we have only one infinity long trajectory, we may encounter the exploration problem.
That's right, yeah. Okay, you're bringing up another interesting question. If my simulation faithfully follows the Markov chain, then I'm going to be encounter states that are preferred by that Markov chain. So when I do my approximation, I'm going to have more samples from the preferential states that this policy likes. And the corresponding approximation is going to be biased towards those preferred states. And so I may have large errors for the other states. The problem of exploration, which I touched upon, you bring it up again. It's a very, very important problem. And also a problem that we're going to deal with on Wednesday, okay? We're going to focus on issues of policy improvement on Wednesday. Today, we're focusing only on issues of policy evaluation without regard of the fact that we're going to need the policy evaluation to do policy improvement with the next policy. So That's let's postpone this question until Wednesday.
Yeah, I just want to continue, or probably clarify the same question. So the first item is that we assume we have this policy, because the market chain is policy dependent. So we assume we have the right policy. And also, we also need to assume that it can generate this long-term stationary frequency of this Kasai.
Yes, yes, the question is that do we need to be able to implement this particular policy? The answer is yes. Somehow, either you need to have some analytical expression, or more likely, to be able to simulate transitions from a given policy. Now, note that even though we do not have the policy as a vector of actions, because that's too big, the assumption is that at any state, we can generate the action of that policy. There's a computer routine that goes in and finds the action of that policy, typically, of course, by just doing a policy improvement on the preceding policy. So in other words, you generate the action and the corresponding transitions as you go. You don't need to have a model ahead of time. And there's no way to avoid that. Yeah.
So I have a question. So in the practice, we always have a very finite number of samples. So is there any results about how long will the sample pass is required to get a accurate enough estimation of BK or CK?
The question has to do with how many samples do we need to have an accurate accurate enough approximation of C and D for this method to work. There are a lot of unanswered questions around this issue. In theory, you would like to have many, many samples. That would make the evaluation of each policy quite expensive. In practice, practitioners actually use very few samples. And put their faith in God, hope that this will work. I have a slide about that.
Especially in some cases, some states are frequently visited, and some other states are very rarely visited. So for these states, which are not frequently visited, how is the estimation currency for these states?
First of all, it's very important to do exploration and to use a somewhat rich sample of states to visit. Also, there are some algorithms that use relatively few samples with each policy evaluation, but at the same time do not make the full change to the new policy. Okay, they change the R vector a little bit, okay? And the iterative methods are better at that. But there's a lot of art in here, and there are few performance guarantees. In theory, you cannot guarantee very much. Theory only gives you an indication of what tricks to try. And then you try them, and hopefully they work. That's the way it is, actually. Okay, so convergence here depends on the law of large numbers, requires an infinite number of samples. And there's also a certain theory of, sometimes these methods are called temporal differences methods. And I'm not going to get into what's a temporal difference. It's basically the sum of these two quantities here. And because these temporal differences appear in all kinds of implementations of this methodology, very often, people view the temporal differences as being an important quantity, and they call the methods temporal difference methods. To me, temporal differences are not all that important. They just happen to appear in various mathematical calculations. But you may make up your own mind if you wish to go a little further into this field. OK, so now let me come to the question of simulation. This is the standard version of approximate policy iteration with an infinite number of samples in between policy evaluations. Instead of calculating nearly exact approximations, it is possible to do a less accurate approximation based on just a few simulation samples, as I mentioned earlier. And this is called optimistic policy iteration. Why is it called optimistic? Well, first of all, we encountered the name optimistic earlier as the variant of policy iteration where you use only a few value iterations to do a policy evaluation. Here, it's a similar setting, but a little different because it refers to the number of simulation samples. There are optimistic methods that just use one sample, and they immediately change the R vector with one sample. Others that use 100 samples, others that use 1,000 samples. Very few methods in practice use an infinite or extremely large number of samples. Often you get better results, but there's no theory really for these methods. Okay, when you have approximation, and oftentimes the behavior is very complex. And in the next lecture, we're going to talk about how oscillations may occur and how these optimistic methods may make the oscillations even worse. Now, here's something that you can say generically. The matrix inversion method inverts an approximation matrix CK, but if the accuracy of this approximation is low, the CK matrix will have a lot of noise. So if you try to invert a matrix that has a lot of noise in it, then you get nonsense very often, particularly if the matrix is nearly singular, as they often are here. So there's a serious problem with the matrix inversion method, because if you have limited sampling, particularly for CL conditioned. The LSP method does not involve this matrix inversion, tends to cope a little better because it's also iterative in nature. It adjusts the vector R little by little, and in the meantime accumulates more relevant samples. It's also possible to put a little step size in front of the correction of the iterative method. This gamma is a step size which can be taken to be small, so that with few samples you do only a small correction here. And the noise is sort of tends to attenuate the simulation noise, this gamma step size. There's a lot of art involved here, and don't expect success the first time you try this.
So the simulation noise is, that means it's not in a stationary state, or maybe just doing some warm-up theory. The simulation noise.
Well, you have. OK, so what is the simulation noise? The question is, what is the simulation noise, and whether it is, when is it harmful? Well, we want to approximate D by something that involves the noise here. So the noise is dk minus D. And similarly here, the more samples that you get, the noise is reduced. On the other hand, still, even the small amount of noise, this matrix may become singular or give you very different inverse than this matrix here. So if you're going to use this matrix inversion method, it's important that you sort of match the amount of simulation that you do to the condition number of that matrix. But clearly, from the point of view of inversion, the more samples you get, the better off you are. But how many you need is not very clear. Okay. Now, there are some generalizations of this methodology that I want to cover in the last part of this lecture. So let's take a break for 10 minutes. I have a few more slides.